I'd like to welcome you to the public meeting for the draft feasibility study for the Salmon Creek Bridge Sandblast Waste Abatement Project. This meeting was requested by the community, and we're happy to be here to share information with you and hear your feedback. My name is Asha Sethi, and I'm a public participation specialist for the Department of Toxic Substances Control. We're one of six departments within the California Environmental Protection Agency, and an important part of our mission is to restore contaminated land in order to protect public health and the environment. I'll be facilitating the public input portion of this meeting and encourage you to provide us with feedback. This meeting is being recorded. You've all entered in viewer mode with cameras and mics turned off. If anyone is in need of live transcription, just click the CC icon at the bottom of the screen to turn on subtitles. Next, I'll go over how to participate in this Zoom webinar. There's two ways you can participate. During the presentation, you can type a question by clicking on the Q&A icon at the bottom of the screen. We do have a lot of content to get through, so please bear with us and we'll respond to them after the end of the presentation. And then after the presentation, we'll also take questions using the raise hand icon, which you can also find at the bottom of the screen. And then when we call on you, you'll be able to unmute yourself at that time. It looks like we do have a couple of folks who have called in. And so for you all to raise your hand, you'll have to dial *9. Raise your hand, and then to unmute yourself, you'll have to dial *6 when it's your turn. And then we'll alternate between phone callers, Q&As typed in, and those that have raised hands. In case we do encounter any technical difficulties, let's do try and have patience with each other. And if you're unfamiliar with using Zoom webinar, we'll do our best to assist you. Next slide, please. And I'd like to introduce you to the other DTSC staff that will be part of tonight's presentation. I've already introduced myself, and now I'd like to introduce you to Tom Landfar, who's a senior environmental scientist and the project manager for this site. Can you say hi, Tom? And then next we have Vivek Mithrani, who's a staff toxicologist. Can you say hi, Vivek?
Good evening, all.
And the last DTSC staff I'd like to introduce you to is John Hope, who's a senior environmental planner. Can you say hi, John?
Good evening, everybody.
Great. Okay, thank you all. Next slide, please. All right, next we'll go over the agenda for this meeting. We'll be going over DTSC's role, the Salmon Creek Bridge sandblast waste investigation and results, the draft feasibility study, the path forward, which would include the Remedial Action Plan and California Environmental Quality Act, or CEQA, as well as future public participation activities. And then we'll have the remainder of the time to answer your questions and hear your feedback. And that's it for opening announcements. And now I'd like to turn it over to Tom.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here. I'm the project manager for the Salmon Creek Bridge Remediation Project. I'm in the Berkeley office for the Site Mitigation and Restoration Program. And the role of our program is the evaluation and cleanup of contaminated properties throughout California. We have two programs with that. One is a voluntary program where we have agreements with the proponents, and then an enforcement program, which we issue orders to compel a responsible party to do the cleanup. The work with Caltrans is through an interagency agreement. It's a voluntary agreement, and DTSC has a contract with Caltrans for the whole state. Then we have individual projects are run through a task order. So we have a specific task order for the Salmon Creek Bridge. There's a roadmap of our process. We start with the evaluation discovery of a site, verify that there was a release. We start to find the contamination and extent, conduct risk assessments. And we completed that phase through for this, for the Salmon Creek Bridge cleanup project. And now we're in the remedy selection phase. The first part of that phase is to evaluate remedy options through a feasibility study. Next, we'll go to a remedial action plan, do our CEQA analysis, which includes public review. Finally, after the approval of the remedial action plan and certification of the CEQA document, we go through implementation, where we have specific designs and monitoring plans. We have the construction and then long-term operation and maintenance and land use restrictions if that's necessary for a site. The purpose of a feasibility study is to evaluate potential cleanup alternatives to support a risk management decision regarding which remedy appears to be most appropriate for a given site. That's what we're doing here now. We're evaluating the different potential remedies. So a feasibility study is kind of like a funnel. You start with the site contaminants, understanding of the site contaminants, the nature and extent. We completed already an eco and human health risk assessment. Through that, we've established our remedial goals. Those are the numeric values that we need to attain in the cleanup. And then when we start working on the remedial, the feasibility study, it starts, one of the early processes is defining the remedial action objectives, what we're trying to accomplish. That's a narrative statement about what we want to accomplish. We screen the potential technologies, things like, covers, in-situ treatment, solidification, exit-to treatment, all these different types of technologies, determine which ones are most appropriate for the site. And that gets us to our alternatives. And then we go through a process of screening those alternatives against the 9 criteria, which is found in the National Contingency Plan. That's the federal document. So we're gonna talk about the location and some details of the site. So most of you know I'm on this call, know where the site is. It's on Highway 1. Just above 126 and south of the town of Albion, where the Salmon Creek enters the Pacific Ocean at Whitesboro Cove. Here's a more detailed map of the site. You can see Highway 1, and this red line delineates the Caltrans state right-of-way. The green lines are the different private parcels. Salmon Creek right there in the middle. Here's a residence, Spring Grove Road. And this, there's two concentration contours. One, the 89 is the contour for the residential cleanup, and 329 is the commercial industrial cleanup goal for the state right of way. This hash mark area shows where an interim action was took place to cover up the gravel road and block any receptors from the lead contamination that was there. The receptors being the people who live in there. So the source of contamination is sandblast waste from the bridge repainting processes that occurred from the 1950s through the 1990s. The metal was sandblasted, the chips would fall, and those chips included the metals, lead and zinc. Since 1999, Caltrans has enclosed the bridge and collected all the sandblast waste. This side here, this is east of the bridge and west of the bridge. So west of the bridge on this side and east, prevailing winds going from west to east. The timeline of our previous investigations. The site discovery started in 2015 with a preliminary site investigation conducted by Caltrans. Because of the results of that investigation, DTSC got involved, and with our oversight, we completed a preliminary endangerment assessment. A preliminary endangerment assessment is really DTSC's first site assessment report, where we look at the data, maybe collect more data, do a preliminary risk assessment, and determine if more investigation and possible cleanup is necessary. The determination was that we would need more investigation, so we followed it with a supplemental site investigation in 2019, ecological risk assessment, in 2020. And then to fill data gaps, we oversaw the completion of an addendum to the site-specific investigation. And that report included a site-specific human health risk assessment. In 2021, Caltrans completed another investigation, the aerial deposited lead site investigation, and collected additional data for Spring Grove Road. So the contaminants and the risk. Lead and zinc was released to the environment through the sandblast waste. And through our risk assessments, we identified lead as both a human and ecological risk. The concentrations of zinc, however, were not high enough to constitute a risk. And so therefore there's no significant human or ecological risk of zinc. So therefore we're focusing on the lead. Human health based lead cleanup goals are also protective of wildlife, meaning that the wildlife goal for lead has a higher concentration than both the residential and the commercial industrial screening levels or target levels that we have for lead. And by meeting the human health cleanup goals, we will also be protected of the ecological receptors. Here is a slide showing our goals for residential. The cleanup goal for lead is 89 milligrams per kilogram. That was, that's a combination of our residential unrestricted screening level of 80 milligrams per kilogram, plus the background concentration at the site that was established at 9 milligrams per kilogram. So the cleanup goal therefore becomes 89. Same with the state right away, where our commercial industrial screening level is 320 milligrams per kilogram. That's also parts per million. Plus background of 9, that gives us 329 milligrams per kilogram. But concentrations of lead in soil. Lead concentrations decrease with distance east of the bridge, with our highest concentration at 6,100 milligrams per kilogram. Low detections of lead was found west of the bridge, and lead concentrations decrease with depth. And lead is generally less than the residential cleanup goal of 89 milligrams per kilogram, 2 feet below the ground surface. That's not every boring, but that's generally the case. And lead in Salmon Creek was sediment was measured and found to really be consistent with our background levels, and it ranged from 3.7 to 11 milligrams per kilogram. Here is a detail of the site with the locations of the different soil boring soil samples. You see west of the bridge, there's samples collected north and south of Salmon Creek. And then we have the samples in the state right away and moving east along north and south of the of Salmon Creek. On this here, it shows you when these were collected. This is from the PEA soil-borne location in 2016, the site investigation in 2015, the supplemental site investigation in 2019, the addendum site investigation in 2020, and the additional work in 2021 on Spring Hill Road right here. You can see these or green squares showing samples collected there. This doesn't include the concentrations. There are figures in the reports that show concentrations attached to these. There's also tables that show the concentrations attached to these. So the site-specific risk assessment was completed with our addendum to the supplemental site investigation. And in that risk assessment, we did an exposure evaluation. I'd like to introduce Vivek Mithrani. He's a staff toxicologist at DTSC, and he's gonna present a few of these slides.
Thanks, Tom. It's just the one slide. So Tom, just two slides ago, showed an overview of the site with the various soil sample locations for lead. So we have a pretty wide extent of samples and also at multiple depths. He also referred to a residential lead cleanup goal for soil at the site, which will define over what extent remediation would have to take place to attain unrestricted land use at the site. So with this cleanup goal being risk-based, anything risk-related entails two factors, exposure and toxicity. With the exposure side, we are identifying the most potentially vulnerable population, which is a child going around the site and having hand-to-mouth contact with soil and ingesting that soil. That child is assumed to ingest 100 milligrams of soil per day all over the site. So the child is given unrestricted access to the site. 100 milligrams of soil, if you took an M&M and cut it into 8 equal pieces like a pizza, it would be one of those pieces. That's about 100 milligrams. Those 100 milligrams of soil that we're assuming for this child ingesting, that's happening 7 days a week for a minimum of 3 months contiguously. And all of these assumptions are to target a soil level, a soil lead concentration level that prevents a 1-point decrease in the child's IQ, given that lead is a neurotoxicant. So as Tom said, the residential exposure, when a site-wide evaluation post-remediation is done, the exposure concentration for a child on site is not to exceed the lead cleanup goal of 89 milligrams per kilogram. And that exposure is a function of the time the child spends, the frequency at which he or she is on the site, and the duration in soil, which is for 16 waking hours. The time spent is all day, the frequency is 7 days a week over a period of 3 months. And since we're talking about potential neurotoxicity in children, I also assessed a scenario where a pregnant woman carrying child was traversing the site all over. And if she were to have hand-to-mouth contact with site soils, her cleanup goal to protect her unborn child would be 220 milligrams per kilogram. So we identified that small child, that toddler, who on their own independently is traversing the site as the site-sensitive receptor, and 89 milligrams per kilogram of lead in soil exposure would be protective. Tom, go ahead.
Thanks. Thank you, Vivek. And I'm going to talk about now remedial action objectives. That's another part of the feasibility study where we have a narrative of what we're trying to accomplish. So the remedial action objectives for this feasibility study is one, to the reduction of exposure to human receptors to lead contaminant soil at concentrations above the residential and state right-of-way remedial goals from incidental ingestion and dermal exposure. So our remedial action objective will identify the receptor, the concentration, which is our remedial goal, and the pathway that we're trying to address, incidental ingestion and dermal exposure. We also have a remedial action objective for ecological receptors. So again, the ecological receptors to lead contaminated soil at concentrations above remedial goals from consumption of vegetation and prey food sources. As I mentioned earlier, meeting the human health remedial goals also protects the ecological receptors. Another step in the draft feasibility study is the identification and screening of technologies. We look at general response actions and process options. So those are things like excavation and offsite disposal, covering with a cap, in situ treatment, ex-situ treatment, solidification, those types of alternatives. And then we identify which alternative is more likely to be acceptable for that site. And that's how we build the list of our alternatives. And then we go to the evaluation of those alternatives. So how we evaluate each alternative is through 9 criteria that's presented in the United States National Contingency Plan. First, there are threshold criteria. And those are criteria that an alternative must meet in order to even be considered. They have to be protected of human health in the environment, and they have to be compliant with state and federal requirements. We have then balancing criteria, which we could compare each one and see how they might do on each of these, you know, long-term effectiveness and performance. That really looks at, again, in the long-term, years from now, what is the likelihood of the remedy still being effective? Reduction of toxicity, mobility, and volume really focuses on, is this a treatment option? Are we doing something to reduce its mobility, you know, like stabilization or toxicity and decreasing its volume? Short-term effectiveness really focuses on what are the impacts of the remedy as it's being implemented. For example, if for this project, if you have excavation that could create dust, the dust could impact people in the community, in the neighborhood. It could transport some other sites. We might do an excavation and there's volatile organic, so you're going to have a lot of vapors and smells and stuff that could be released. So those are the type of things we look at as short-term effectiveness. And then implementability is, can you implement that remedy at the site? And finally, costs. Modifying criteria are regulatory acceptance and community acceptance. Regulatory acceptance in this case would be other state agencies like the Water Board, Fish and Wildlife, Mendocino County, for example. Community acceptance is you folks out there, the community. And, you know, in the remedial action plan, we'll have opportunity for public comment. And that's when we really gauge community acceptance is in the remedial action plan. So all the alternatives that made it through all that, one, the no action alternative, that one's required to be included in the feasibility study, but it's really not a true alternative. It's one that we compare the other ones with. So what would happen if we didn't do anything is that alternative. Number two is institutional controls. That's things like land use restrictions that would limit the use and access of a site. Three, in situ containment, and that primarily is would be excavation and then containment within the state right away. Four is complete removal. So all of the soil that's above a remedial goal would be removed, taken off site, transported off site, and disposed of elsewhere. And alternative five is a targeted removal where not all the soil is removed, but only that which has the highest contamination levels. And with this removal would allow that the exposure scenario that Vivek spoke about. I have it in green because that's at the end of the feasibility study, that's the recommended alternative to be considered in the remedial action plan. So here is a figure showing at targeted removal, where we have in the yellow area would be removed, excavated, transported offsite, and disposed of offsite. And then these purple hashed areas would remain in place. This is a photograph showing the area, some of the area that would be remain in place. You can see the heavily vegetated steep slope, probably not a place where a child would have access to. So the target removal, one, it's protective of residential use, the first criteria. Is it protective of human health and environment? So the site-wide exposure would not exceed residential lead cleanup goal. Excuse me, site-wide exposure would not to exceed the residential lead cleanup goal of 89 milligrams per kilogram based on the exposure, time, frequency, duration in the soil for portions of the site that are not accessible. And the state right-of-way exposure is not to exceed commercial industrial cleanup goal of 329 milligrams per kilogram. A couple of the short-term impacts we talked about with the targeted removal, we would have less disturbance of native vegetation in shallow soils and also reduces the truckloads of soil for offsite disposal over the full excavation, full removal. So path forward is to draft and release a remedial action plan in 2022. This is DTSC's decision document, and it does have a public comment period, and it also must be compliant with the California Environmental Quality Act. And I'm going to introduce John Hope, who is a senior environmental planner, Department of Toxics. He's going to talk a bit about the California Environmental Quality Act.
Thank you, Tom. Yes, my name is John Hope. I am a senior environmental planner with DTSC. And I'll start off with a general description of what CEQA is for people that may not know. So CEQA is an acronym that stands for the California Environmental Quality Act. And that is a state law that requires every project in the state to go through an environmental analysis. And for this project, for these cleanup activities, the activities themselves are going to have to go through an environmental analysis because they are considered a project in themselves. And for this environmental analysis, DTSC will be taking the lead agency under CEQA. Caltrans, even though they are the essentially the owners of the right-of-way and responsible for the lead contamination, they are an applicant to DTSC. And again, as Tom mentioned earlier, the draft remedial action plan is considered our decision-making document. And so the environmental analysis will be focusing on the cleanup activities as described in the draft wrap. It will be focusing on what's described in there. It'll also include the supporting evidence that's provided in the technical studies. So we have various technical studies being prepared for this project. As an example, we have a biological study being prepared. I believe cultural resources, traffic will be, a specific study will be prepared for traffic. And so those specific technical studies and what's provided and conclusions are made in those studies will be identified and summarized in the environmental analysis. So because we have not received the actual draft wrap at this point, CEQA actually hasn't quite kicked in yet for this project. So the first step that we are required to do under CEQA is to prepare an initial study, and that actually will start when we receive the draft wrap from Caltrans. And once we receive that draft wrap, that kicks in a certain time period in which we have to prepare the initial study and also make a determination as to what direction and what type of CEQA document that we will be preparing. That could be, for this case, it could be anything from a mitigated negative declaration or an EIR, but that hasn't been determined at this point, again, because we have not received the draft wrap yet. And again, the initial study itself, when we use that analysis to determine what direction we need to go for the CEQA document, that will include review of the technical studies. Those conclusions that are provided in those studies will guide us and direct us in what direction we need to go for the document. And I will turn this back over. I believe I'll turn this back to Asha.
Thank you, John, and thank you to Tom and Vivek for the presentation as well. Next, yeah, there we go. Now I'll go over future public participation activities that will be associated with the draft remedial action plan. So we're quite early in the process. Go back to the previous slide, please. Thank you. So we're quite early in the process since we are still in the feasibility study phase, but you will be hearing from us soon about some additional steps associated with the draft remedial action plan. The next couple of months, we plan to send out a community letter and survey and hope to hear from as many of you as possible so we can gauge who all has an interest in the site. And from that response, we hope to schedule community interviews, which will be either online or by phone, to better understand community concerns and interests. And then after we complete the community assessment process, and when the draft remedial action plan is ready for public review, we'll be announcing that through the mail out of a community update, as well as placing a public notice in the local paper. And during the public comment period, we will be holding another public meeting, which is also likely to be online, unfortunately. We'll see how things go. So you'll be hearing more from us by mail and email for those of you that we have contacts for. So please stay tuned for more to come. Next slide, please. And then in the meantime, if you'd like additional information about the site, you have a couple of options for a hard copy of the draft feasibility study. You can visit the Mendocino Community Library and review a copy of it available at the front desk. You can also access all the project related documents on our EnviroStore database listed here. To get to the Salmon Creek Bridge page, you type in the name and then you'll have to select it from the drop down menu. And then once you get there, you click on the community involvement tab to find the document. And while you're on that EnviroStore page, you can sign up to receive email alerts when new documents are uploaded. And please don't hesitate to reach out if you need assistance, and I can walk you through it or send you any direct links for documents you're looking for. Next slide, please. So here's contact information for both Tom and I. Please feel free to get in touch with us anytime. As you've heard, there'll be future opportunities for public participation, and over the next few months, you'll be receiving additional mailers from us once we start the process for the draft remedial action plan. So that takes us to the end of our presentation. And now we really want to hear from you. And just a reminder, you have two ways to participate. You can either click on the raise hand icon at the bottom of the screen, or use the Q&A feature and type in your question or comment. And for anyone who's calling in order to raise your hand, you'll have to dial *9. So let me take a look and see here who we have. Okay, the first hand I see up, let's see, is guest. So I'm gonna go ahead and unmute you. Go ahead and should be able to speak now. Guest, are you able to unmute yourself? There you are.
Can you hear me now? Okay. I'm Mark Schoen. I live at 2490 Nonella Lane. So I'm south and west of the bridge, very slightly south. And I'm very curious about Tom's comment about the prevailing wind being west to east, because, and I guess my question is, have you collected data on wind direction? Because the prevailing wind that we're used to is mostly from the north to the south, unless it's a storm, and that's from the south to the north.
Great question. Tom?
Thank you for that question. And you know, you live there and you experience that daily. And I think my assumption was based on the, and that statement was based on the distribution of the sandblast waste and the lead contamination, which is, you know, from the bridge east, and we have declining concentration as we go east, and we don't have the, you know, very high concentrations at all west of the bridge.
Well, that that may be true for the concentrations of the lead, but if you do a removal project based on the assumption that it's from the West, and it turns out that what I'm experiencing at my house is also true at the bridge, which is, I don't know, 500 feet away, maybe slightly more. And then we experience dust particles and so forth that are blown in our direction, we would become concerned. And we would want you to be aware of that as you study how you're going to mitigate the removal.
Yeah. And the implementation plan and in the CEQA document will look at dust mitigation and air monitoring. So what would be required are air monitors around the site. So we make sure we monitor that and make sure that the dust isn't leaving the site. We would have wind direction, you know, socks or other ways to look at the change of the wind. There also be controls in place to keep the dust from even being generated, like, you know, applying water and other things. So dust is a very important impact that needs to be controlled. And I think I take that really seriously, DTSC does. So if there's a dust monitoring, air monitoring, and a dust control plan that would you know, measure and make sure that dust isn't leaving the site. If there are problems, then one is you'll have our phone numbers and if something is happening and you could call us and make us aware and we'll check things out.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Okay, the next hand that is raised is from Bill. Please go ahead, Bill. All right, Bill, can you go ahead and unmute yourself now?
Put that back up. I can't.
We can hear you. We can hear you now.
Okay, I got it.
Yeah, great.
Thank you. I'm Bill Heil. I've lived in Albion over 50 years and used to go down to Salmon Creek Beach back when there was a little house on the west side and a friend lived down there. I want you all to be aware that Salmon Creek is a fish-bearing stream and is very important for the salmon coho. And I'm wondering what kind of options you have for making sure that the lead, which seems a lot heavier than water and such, is not migrating down into the benthic or whatever they call it and into the water and being harmful to fish. And if there's anything that can be done about that. It is the timber company that owns the biggest part of Salmon Creek watershed has gone to great lengths to restore the stream and make it feasible for the salmon to coho salmon to return. And I'm also one of the officers of Salmon Creek. Albion Bridge stewards who are concerned with Salmon Creek as well as the Albion Bridge, and we'll be either have or will be sending a letter with some of our other concerns. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Tom, would you like to respond?
Yeah, so, you know, there's a couple of things. One, Salmon Creek is right there under the bridge, west of the bridge, and east of the bridge, and we know that the paint chips and lead was falling also into the creek. However, through floods and just the flow of the creek, you know, that lead was removed and taken out into the ocean. We have samples in the creek and pore water, and it, you know, those samples show that the current condition in Salmon Creek won't affect wildlife. The other aspect is during the implementation of the remedy, you know, it involves excavation up to some of the, up to the shoreline or the edge of the creek, and there'd have to be mitigations and engineering controls to ensure that that there's no increased erosion into the creek. And again, that would be part of the technical studies and detailed plans that would go, you know, be talked about in the remedial action plan in the CEQA document, but specifically laid out in a remedial design plan.
Thanks, Tom. It looks like the next hand that's raised is from Robert. Go ahead and unmute yourself, Robert. Are you still there, Robert? Okay, it looks like, did we lose you? I'll give you a moment. You'll have to go ahead and click to unmute yourself now. Okay, Robert, we'll come back to you. We will go to Carrie next. Carrie, go ahead and unmute yourself.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you for being there. So the current feasibility study failed to recognize that the site is located in the coastal zone, where the Coastal Act, the County Local Coastal Plan, and the federally approved California Coastal Management Program apply. Assuming that Caltrans is using some federal funds for this project, the National Environmental Policy Act also applies. This is all in addition to CEQA. Caltrans does not appear to have addressed even all the department's recommendations, requests, and directives. As a result, the final feasibility study remains incomplete and inadequate. My recommendation is that the study needs to be redone before the scoping, preparation, and public review of a combined ERREIS can begin. Thank you very much. I hope you consider these aspects.
Thank you very much. And the Coastal Act is a state law that applies. And the feasibility study has a section that's the applicable, relevant, and appropriate requirements. And that's where we lay out all the laws, all the rules and regulations that need to be followed in implementing the various alternatives and finally the remedy. And those were identified in the feasibility study, the Coastal Act and the requirement for coastal development permits. The feasibility study itself doesn't require that. The implementation of the remedy would require that, and that would be looked at also in the California Environmental Quality Act document that we will prepare.
Thank you, Tom. Okay, Robert, we're going to try you again here. Let's see if we can hear you this time. Robert, I wonder if it'd be possible if you're able to type something into the Q&A. If you go to the bottom of the screen and click the Q&A icon. If you click that and type in your comment, then I can read it out loud. I'm sorry that we're having trouble hearing you. Okay, while we're waiting for, hopefully we'll hear from Robert through the Q&A. Do we have any other hands raised or any questions or comments from anyone? Okay. Next, we have Anne-Marie. I'm going to go ahead and allow you to unmute yourself there.
Can you hear me?
You sure can. Nice to hear your voice.
Yeah, nice to see you. Last time you were in Fort Bragg dealing with the toxins at the mill site.
No.
And I hope they'll be cleaned up with the new Blister Skunk train. Anyway. Back to this issue. Thanks for having this Zoom meeting. I hope you'll also turn it into video so people who couldn't be here could see it.
We sure will.
My name is Anne-Marie Weibel. I am an Albion Bridge steward and Albion resident since 1983. I believe that the sampling was incomplete and none of the five alternatives are either sufficient to restore the lower Salmon Creek Valley wetland, riparian, bluff face, estuarine habitats, or to comply with Coastal Act and LCP regulatory standards, just like Carrie mentioned as well. And looking over the feasibility study letter from October 14th, it looks like especially areas number 2, 3, 4, and 7 were not sufficiently changed. Also, there was a reference about unpermitted water connection, and this setup is totally dilapidated. Who knows, if how that water is and if it was tested. And then also, the different criteria you set up, it seems that with better studies, and that it seems like you need to scrap this study, it's not a final study, it really didn't address so many of the issues. So the other thing, if it would be carried away, the toxins from Albion, of course, nobody wants it in their backyard, but to bring it to a site like Kettleman City, and I went into detail in my personal letter about this, concerns me a lot, because there have been clusters of burst effects found there, infant deaths, and all pointing to chemical waste, and the incinerators are always tend to be located in locations with predominantly non-white populations. In addition, these chem waste companies were fined by the millions of dollars, but they keep filling these land sites. So I am very concerned about many issues, not just transporting it away from here, but it really seems that we need to have at least 30 more days to submit comments, and that this study needs to be redone because it is really not adequate. And when our group, the Albion Bridge Stewards, attended the Mendocino County Planning Commission, we were informed that these areas would just be covered up, and because the relatives wanted to use it. And now that we look on the map on page 48 and 49, we see that it says that the interim mitigation lead impacted soil capping was completed but there were no tests done before they were covered up. There were probably more toxins spread. And this area is not done. It's not completed. It was just covered up with cloths and rocks and, you know, moved around. I mean, when we're thinking of high tides, low tides, storm surges, rain, also the Caltrans did testing and threw away 60 feet of sand samples. This is not okay because, you know, it is heavy, it goes down, the toxins go down. You didn't go down deep enough with all of these testings, and there's many areas that weren't tested. And so Caltrans is wanting to get this area ready to tear down this bridge as soon as possible. And all this is also in with that interest in mind. We had to stop the Mendocino County Planning and Building Services Department because work was doing done without permits. That was on 10/4/2018. So personally, and also, you know, as a member of Albion Bridge Stewards who is concerned about anything that Caltrans does in our area, I'm very concerned that this feasibility study is not feasible and has to go back to the drawing board. Thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you very much. There's a lot there, and I appreciate your, good to hear your voice again, and kind of good to be back in the community, although I'm not back in the community, so I really can't say that. Well, there's a lot there. Asha, do you have any, can you help me with any specific question?
Yes, and maybe, we'll make some notes and see if we can touch on some of these points. And if we missed anything, maybe Anne-Marie can jump in. But the first thing I heard from Anne-Marie was that inadequacy of the sampling for the site. Could you talk a bit about how the site was sampled and the extent and how it was determined, what the depths were and how far and wide?
Okay, let me the back. So here's the site with the locations of the soil samples. And you can see that we have quite a bit of extent. Now, this is a large area, and therefore, you know, the distance between the samples might be, you know, sometimes maybe 50 feet. Sometimes maybe 100 feet, but we have a lot of extent, and it shows the trend of the contamination. And we know that within the hash marks, the 89 hash mark and the 320, that we expect within that area, the concentrations are going to be greater than the 89 or the 320. Now, when we do the removal action, we'll be following that up with, or if we do the removal action, when an excavation is done at any of our sites, we follow up with confirmation sampling to see if we met that. So, you know, you mentioned the road that was covered as an interim protective measure. And, you know, there were some samples near that road, but the assumption is that underneath that road is contaminated and that would be part of the excavation area that's identified in alternative, the target removal. So if it falls in within the excavation area, it would be removed and excavated. The most sample points go down 2 or 3 feet. Sometimes they went down to bedrock. And if you look at the data tables, you can see that as we go down in depth below ground surface, the concentrations decrease. So we have a pretty good idea of how deep the excavation needs to be. And there's some areas that we didn't have access. When I say we, you know, as the project manager and overseeing that, I think of the we as the team, and sometimes they weren't able to access area because of steep vegetation and limits on the ability to, you know, get into those areas. And the extent of sampling was extensive, and I believe that it is adequate to complete a feasibility study and to find a risk and to evaluate the alternatives.
Next thing I heard Anne-Marie speaking about was the issue of transporting the waste away to mm-hmm. other communities. Do you want to touch on that, Tom?
Yeah, that is always an issue and a concern. And the proposal put forward in Alternative 5, the target removal, still includes a lot of excavated soil and a lot of truck trips. And what we would make sure is that any truck leaving the site is cleaned, is covered, follows the appropriate truck routes, and that no soil, for example, is tracked out. When a truck leaves, if they haven't been cleaned properly, the dust could and the dirt could be on their tires, and then they track it out in the community. But ultimately, our system has waste disposal areas that we take contamination from an area that is not appropriate to have, and is because of the risk assessment and the ecological risk that a action needs to happen. And sometimes that action is excavation, transportation, and offsite disposal facility. So one of the benefits of the target removal is it reduces the amount of trucks and the amount of soil that would be removing offsite.
Thanks, Tom. And another request from Anne-Marie was for 30 days for the comment period. And Anne-Marie, I can tell you that's something that we will take into consideration. Thank you so much for your comments, Anne-Marie. If we didn't get to anything, just feel free to raise your hand again, but I'm gonna move on now to, looks like Robert, I think Robert, you've unmuted yourself. So hopefully you can speak to us now. You wanna go ahead and try?
Hi, hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, my question is about the spread of the contaminant. So looking at this map here, outside the yellow zone, I see there are some data points, it looks like. And then beyond those areas where there's no data points, does that mean that there's no contaminants there or it's just not tested?
Where there's no data points, it hasn't been tested. What we do see though is a decrease in the contamination in those data points. And then beyond that wasn't accessible. So the points weren't collected there.
Mm. Can we assume that it will be, it's the soil there is okay?
Excuse me?
Can we assume that the soil there is okay, that there's no contaminants?
Well, we know that the contamination levels in that area is reduces as you move east from the bridge. And that's an area, I think I want to make sure we're talking about this here, this area here, and down further. So this area here was inaccessible. Again, the levels here decrease. And this is also an area that we would leave in place. The concentration there is above 89, but the exposure level is about 150 or 160 lead milligrams per kilogram. And because they're inaccessible, really, there's not the likely exposure to the human health receptor.
Okay. Also, did you guys test the water, the seawater?
The seawater? No, we did not test the seawater. We test pore water in the creek. And the pore water is the water that's in the sediment. And pore water is really a good indicator of contamination, because that's even more than the sediment itself. It has, the critters in the sediment have more access to the water, and the pore water, I forgot the concentration, but it was below any ecological screening levels.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Okay, so next we have Jim, and then after Jim, it'll be Norbert. Thanks for your patience. So Jim, go ahead and unmute yourself.
I am indeed unmuted. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank DTSC for holding this meeting and for keeping the community informed about the cleanup of this beautiful, really sensitive part of the Mendocino Coast. And also special thanks to you for moderating this meeting so patiently. You've probably said the word unmute more than you ever imagined that you would.
Well, thank you all for bearing with us in this awkward format. Yeah, but it's what we have now. Yeah.
Well done. Bravo. I just have a couple of brief comments. First, there is a mention of in numerous places in the feasibility study where there's a mention of Caltrans' proposed plans to replace the Salmon Creek Bridge. Section 1.0, 1.2, section 4.2.2, section 5.2.1, and 5.4. And this mention of Caltrans' proposed plans strikes me as irrelevant. Regardless of the future of the Salmon Creek Bridge, the area beneath the bridge is polluted by decades of improper environmental protection. So I would respectfully suggest that references to the future of the bridge, whatever it might be removed from the feasibility study, since really the future of the bridge is not related to the existing problems on the ground and the need to mitigate them. Second, I was going to comment on the need for a traffic study regarding the thousands of truckloads of contaminated soils on the county and state highways. I was also going to comment on the need for an EIR and or EIS, but I'm happy to hear from the CEQA representative who spoke earlier that these things may indeed be included or required when CEQA receives and has a chance to study the feasibility study, because it certainly seems like likely that that all of the above would be needed. And then finally, although I'm speaking here as a 32-year resident of Albion who lives more or less downwind from the Salmon Creek Bridge, I am also speaking as a member of the Albion Bridge Stewards. And I would just like to reiterate the request that Anne-Marie made earlier and that we noted in our letter sent earlier, and thank you, Tom, for acknowledging receipt of that, to respectfully request that the comment period, the public comment period on the feasibility study itself be left open through February so that we and other community members have more of a chance to provide additional written comments. Thank you again very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
I think that the comment about the bridge replacement, that's not part of this project. I think that sometimes it might be helpful as far as the context, but the bridge replacement has nothing to do with it's not the part of this project. And if the bridge wasn't been going, if there wasn't plans for a bridge replacement, we would still be talking about the cleanup because the lead was released and it's in the environment and it poses a risk. So we have to address that.
Great, thank you. Okay, next we will go to Norbert, who has been waiting very patiently. Let's see, Norbert, your hand went back down, so you're not at the top of my screen, so I'm scrolling and searching for you here. Bear with me. Okay, there we go. You raised your hand again. Perfect. Okay. Okay, we can hear you now.
Good evening. I'm Norbert Dahl. I've researched Albion environmental conditions and worked to protect and restore them since 1967 when I was in high school. I commend the department for its professional work that has been done. And also I'm very mindful, as I'm sure you are, of the immense amount of work that needs to be done to bring this feasibility study into compliance with all the applicable laws and regulations. Let me just summarize a couple of key points. First of all, Salmon Creek, Little Salmon Creek, are major coastal zone aquatic, terrestrial, and avian wildlife corridors. And alongside of them, as you can see, in part, is the historic Spring Grove Road, which constitutes a state and federally designated public access corridor all the way to the beach. That's important because when I have read now multiple times over the draft final FS, I see no discussion whatsoever of the proposed alternative 5 in terms of its consistency with all of the applicable standards of review other than CERCLA. And for that reason alone, I would respectfully submit to you that the GEOCON document from October of last year is fundamentally flawed, incomplete, and not available for the department to proceed with the RAP. What I would urge the department to do, as others have tonight, is to begin with a real constraints analysis that documents the actual quantity and distribution of the toxic waste materials from the sandblasting of this bridge since 1950. That by itself is altogether missing from the study. Similarly, there is no basis, no baseline information, as one of the gentlemen who spoke earlier noted, with regard to actual wind conditions between 1950 and 1999, when Caltrans or the State Division of Highways and its contractors or their contractors repeatedly engaged in what, at least since 1969, have been violations of state and federal water quality law. And since 1973, violations of California coastal law. So what I would very strongly urge is, forgive me, I want to go to one other point quickly. And that is, I have looked very carefully and analytically at the sampling methodology that was used here. It has fundamental flaws because it is not random. It is not weighted based on wind distribution, for instance, of lead or zinc. And for a whole host of other reasons, which I'll go into in my written comments, the sampling protocol that was used here does not stand for the proposition that the department knows where the highest concentrations of lead, just to use one example, are. Now, it is very interesting that one of the highest concentrations is off the Vista Point at the southeasterly end, strike that, southwesterly end of the bridge. And that looks as though it's an anthropogenic dump site. Similarly, as one of the earlier speakers mentioned, at Caltrans drill site 3A, immediately adjacent to the north tower of the bridge on the east side, Caltrans performed geotechnical investigations that produced, by Caltrans's statement, 60 vertical feet of sand. Notably, the GEOCON study does not analyze the content of that sample. Why not? I would submit to you that there are experts in statistical analysis who should be consulted to do a proper sampling, and they need to take into account one thing in addition, and that is Caltrans has engaged in repeated unpermitted grading development, meaning excavation and fill, along Spring Grove Road by dumping a site adjacent to a tributary to Little Salmon Creek, an anadromous fishery. That's not a sample site. Anyone who drives down Spring Grove Road sees it on the left side just before you get to the bottom. Why was that not sampled? Because it is clearly full of material that Caltrans excavated from the top of Spring Grove Road all the way down to that location and even beyond. Similarly, and this is my last comment, and thank you for granting the time, much of the site on the north side of Salmon Creek is California jurisdictional wetlands. Wetlands have a substantial body of protected law in California, and remarkably and erroneously, the Geocon report doesn't analyze that. There are certain things one cannot do in wetlands in California. And one of them is to excavate the soil and then bring in soil, which may or may not be wetland soil, meaning hydric soil, to fill it. That is just a non-starter from the start. Similarly, and lastly, on the south side, on the Funky property, and partly Magruder Poly, there are areas that are immediately adjacent to marble murrelet habitat. And it is notable that the curve at the easterly end of the south polygon for remediation stops just short of what some of the locals call Funky Hill. Funky Hill is a site for marbled murrelet roosting and possibly nesting. So in summary, if you please, and Tom, greetings to you. This feasibility study is not adequate by methodology, by content, by analysis, and alternative five is infeasible because it's inconsistent with the county LCP, the California Coastal Act, and the federally approved California Coastal Management Program. In closing, I have one question, if you know the answer. Is any part of this work, whether by Geocon or by the department, funded with federal monies? Because if it is, there's a whole additional train of requirements that applies. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Norbert. One point I would make is that Caltrans is responsible for the release of the lead, and that is why they're the responsible party, and that's why they're cleaning up the site. That's why we're here. And so Caltrans is being held responsible for that. And we're looking at a feasibility study to, you know, evaluate different ways that we might address that contamination and the risk that is that the lead poses to human health and environment. You know, many of the studies that you talk about aren't part of the scope of a feasibility study. They are part of the scope of remedial action plan. They are part of the scope of the CEQA analysis. The laws you mentioned, I will check again, but I believe all the Coastal Act laws that you mentioned were identified as applicable regulations and laws. And therefore any activity would have to meet those laws, get the required permits, get the required permissions to do things within the coastal zone. So the feasibility study itself doesn't need to get those kind of permits. It's just a study. When we go from the studies to now we're going to do some implementation, at that point, the proper permits need to be had and applied, you know, and met. there has been, you know, whenever we have a site where we have wetlands and we have ecological sensitive areas, that is a, you know, complication, and it requires more consideration, more study, and to make sure that the cleanup doesn't create more harm than the, you know, leaving things in place. But there are sites up and down the state of California where wetlands have been remediated. We did that up in Fort Bragg. There were wetlands that were contaminated with dioxin, for example, and we did excavations and then they did restoration of those wetlands. So it is possible to remediate a wetland, but you have to mitigate and you have to restore that wetland. And so all of those types of studies you're talking about are not part of the scope of a feasibility study. The feasibility study that we looked at meets the US EPA guidance for a feasibility study. It meets DTSC's standard for a feasibility study. The investigations were completed over several years, iterations of identifying data gaps, filling those data gaps, identifying more and filling those data gaps. So when we move to a remedial action plan, we still carry all of those alternatives to that remedial action plan. And those alternatives then have even more evaluation. And those alternatives are also carried into our initial study in CEQA and to see if, you know, what are the impacts and is it a feasible alternative? So we continue and continue and continue to evaluate. And the kind of the studies that you're speaking of aren't part of a feasibility study. They're part of later studies.
Thanks, Tom. And then did you have a response to his question about federal funds?
I don't know that. Okay. I don't know if the cleanup action itself has any federal funding.
Okay.
But we could check with Caltrans and see if that's the case.
Okay. All right. Thank you. And it looks like next we're going to go to, first there was a follow-up from Jim, just a follow-up to the comment about removing reference to the proposed project. And then next we've got a chat from Terry Searles. And I'll just read out the comment from Terry. Let's see here, so you can read along. So my name is Terry Searles, and some of the contamination appears to be on my property on the southwest side of the study area. I had given permission for folks to do chemical sampling and biological studies. As a caveat to that permission, I had asked for the data from these surveys to be sent to me. This is the first I've heard that some of these higher readings appear to be on my property. Please send them to me.
So is that the property here, 123-36-07?
This property here. Terry, are you able to turn your audio on? I can try and unmute you. You want to raise your hand so I can find you here in the list of attendees. You'll pop up to the top. And then Terry, why don't we just make sure we have your contact information, if you don't mind just typing that into the Q&A, and I'll make note of that and we can follow back up with you if you're not able to unmute yourself right now or raise your hand, we'll get back to you on your request. Okay. So let's see who we have next, and let's just do a time check here. We've just got about 8 minutes. So let's go to, we've got another hand raised. Let's see, we've got Stephanie Dahl. Go ahead and unmute yourself.
Thank you. I have a few questions. The first is that an earlier speaker inquired as to confirmation as to whether there was any federal funding involved in any of the stages of this work. And I may have missed the answer, but if you'd be willing to share it again.
Yeah, I am not sure if federal funding is being used for the cleanup action. And we will look at that.
All right. Well, my next question was with respect to the schedule for CEQA, and if one is doing CEQA and federal funds are involved, presumably NEPA would be required as well. So there is a question in that, and that is, what is the schedule anticipated roughly for undertaking the environmental studies that were referenced?
The schedule for the environmental studies would be this spring, and you know, the in 2022 in the coming months.
All right, and what kind
let me qualify that, is that when we receive the remedial action plan, the draft remedial action plan, we will then receive the technical studies because now we have a project. Right now, we don't have a project. The remedial action plan begins to define that project. We look at it, the initial study, based on that project. What we have right now is a feasibility study that makes a recommendation, but it really doesn't define the project. So we need to get to the remedial action plan for us to get those technical studies and begin preparing the initial study.
And the remedial action. I'm sorry, the remedial action plan is anticipated?
Next few months. It depends when we finish the feasibility study. And a lot of the information and the questions are really about the initial study for CEQA and the technical studies that will support our initial study for CEQA. And I'm anxiously awaiting that part of the project. So I'm anxious to get past the feasibility study so we can get into the weeds of these questions that we have.
Hopefully all non-native. The next question, and this is schedule related, and thank you for entertaining these questions. When the remedial action plan is out, will that become a public document as well?
Yes, all our documents are public in that the public can look at them.
Right, will there be notice to the public, I guess?
Yes.
Yeah.
That would be notice to the public. The feasibility study isn't that type of a document. We usually do not have meetings like this.
Right.
We don't have public comment periods. It's a document that DTSC will look at, provide comments and back and forth. Yeah. But if there's concern and interested people in the community, they have the opportunity and the right to see that. They have the opportunity and the right to communicate with DTSC.
Right. There are a number of people participating in this discussion, and I'm sure you've gotten comments or will get additional comments. Will people who are commenting or on your email mailing list also be notified when these various additional documents and information become available?
Yes, you wanna take that?
Yeah, I'll speak to that. Yeah, absolutely. Everything's gonna be posted on EnviroStore, and I definitely encourage you to sign up to get those EnviroStore alerts. So anytime Tom uploads a new technical document, that's available for you to see as soon as he uploads that. And whenever the draft remedial action plan is ready for public review, most definitely. And that's more of a formal process. You know, we're meeting with you tonight because you all requested it. But for the draft, but for the draft remedial action plan, that's a formal process. So there's requirements. So there is the requirement of a public meeting. And so we would be noticing that. We'll be sending mailers out to announce the launch of the public comment period. We'll also be putting a public notice in the paper. So you'll have opportunities and lead time for, you'll know the dates of the comment period and you'll know the date of the public meeting, and everybody on the mailing list, as well as all the emails that we've been collecting, will get that notice. So we have a pretty good email list starting point, but we're hoping to get more. And we'll be developing that through sending out the letter and the survey. You know, one of the questions we have there is, is there anyone else that we should get in touch with? And we ask you for your email contact, so we make sure that we're, reaching out as broadly as we can. And, really doing our best to reach out to everyone, because right now we've got, a group of folks who are really interested, that have been engaging with DTSC over the years, but we want to make sure we're not missing anyone.
Fantastic. I have one comment, sorry. I have one final question, and I think as the preface, I will say I'm speaking probably for most people participating in this, and our appreciation that your agency is acting as the lead agency for CEQA purposes here. But my question is, typically when a public agency is undertaking the action, that public agency, in this case Caltrans, would typically serve as the lead agency for CEQA review. And I'm just curious as to what, in this particular instance, triggers your agency becoming the lead agency.
I think I could handle that, and maybe John could help, is that we're the lead agency because we're making the decision on the document. We're making the approval. So CEQA requires a project and a decision, and that decision is being done by DTSC, not by Caltrans.
I understand that, but in the coastal program, for example, in the county of Mendocino, for example, Caltrans serves as the lead agency and they are responsible agencies. And I, I can tell you that we think that you are doing a very fine job in your public outreach, and we're glad that you're in that position. It was just, surprising. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. And I want to make sure another statement about EnviroStore and the documents. So EnviroStore, that public, and if you type Salmon Creek Bridge, there'll be a drop down. You can click on that. Don't just push enter, because if you push enter, you're going to go to a Google Maps and it's going to put you someplace in Oregon. So you have to wait for those things to drop down and then click on the Salmon Creek Bridge project. And then there's going to be a page, and you're going to have a button for activities, and you're going to have another one for community involvement. When a document is final, like approved, it will go under the activities tab. So you could go on activities and you could see all the past investigation reports, work plans, DTSC approval letters, DTSC comments, all that stuff is under activities. But until the upcoming remedial action plan is released for a public document, it will be under community involvement, but we have a special place in there for draft documents for public review. But what we're going to do is we'll include it in another part of the community involvement tab, and it's further down, and it's project related documents. So right now under that community involvement tab, the draft feasibility study is, that's why it's in the community involvement tab, not activities, because it's not approved yet. But I put it up there so that you folks could have access to it. And we'll do the same thing with the remedial action plan as well. So before it's a public document, the first time we get our draft document, we'll share it and you can look at it. We're gonna be reviewing it, commenting. It could take a couple back and forth before DTSC accepts it as now ready for public review. And then it will be released for public review. So just want to clarify that the draft document, the initial draft, may not be the one for public review. We'll review it, comment on it, and it's only until we're happy with it and feel like it's, ready for prime time, then it will be, we'll public notice it, have the community update, and open up a public comment period.
Great. Thank you, Tom. And thank you, Stephanie, for the questions and comments. We got a request at the Q&A for how to sign up for our email list. Tom, would you mind going back a slide that has our, or going forward a slide that has our contact information on it? I went ahead and put it in the chat, but here's both mine and Tom's contact information. So yeah, if you're having trouble with, you know, getting a hold of any documents or navigating in Barstor, please don't hesitate to call me. Our phone lines now ring right into our computer. So it's really easy now. We don't have to play phone tag. It's easy to get a hold of us, and we're happy to help, you know, walk you through Barstor. We are after eight now, but there is one more hand raised. So I think this will be, Dan has his hand raised, and this will be our last question of the evening. So go ahead, Dan, and unmute yourself.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, welcome.
Awesome. Well, Tom and Asha and the whole team, I just wanted to say thank you on behalf of the Salmon Creek property owners for all of the years, literally years of work that you guys have been doing to make this project successful. And I know that we're excited to see it move forward. Not only for us and our family and the youth and my young children that are on the property during the year, but also, as Minnie mentioned here, for all of the wildlife that definitely frequents the area. And I know that I'm sure everyone's very anxious to get the project completed appropriately for all parties involved. So I just want to say on behalf of us, thank you very much for all of your work.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Thanks for speaking for the property owners. It's great to hear from you. And thank you, everyone. That was a really wonderful, robust dialogue. We really appreciate your engagement. We miss coming out there to see you in person, but we will look for opportunities. And if you have any additional questions or feedback that we didn't get to this evening, you know, please don't hesitate to email us or call us. And thank you so much for spending the evening with us. Have a good night, everyone.